Holy Father, we come collectively as the body of Christ. Third service. We've done the Sabbath. We've done the nine. Now here we are. We come collectively as your people. We come washed in the blood of Jesus. We come as one new creation, one new nation. And we stand before you today in the mighty name of our King Jesus. And we lift up our nation. We lift up our President Obama. We lift up the President-elect Trump. We lift up all of our senators. We lift up our Congress and our Supreme Court. And Almighty Father, we pray that the fear of God would be upon them. We pray, Almighty God, that righteousness would rule this nation. We pray, Almighty God, that you would begin to speak to them as never before, and that everything that the enemy has meant for evil, that as you hold the heart of the king in your hand, Almighty Father, turn the heart of the king, turn our presidents, turn our Congress, turn our Supreme Court, turn our Senate, turn the White House to do your will and your bidding. May righteousness reign in this nation from the north, the south, the east, and the west. May there be a revival such as we have never seen. May the word of God begin to echo forth from the corners of this land. Come your kingdom, be done your will. And as we open your word, open our hearts. As we open our ears, give us ears to hear. Grant us eyes to see. Oh, spirit of wisdom, spirit of revelation, we cannot know any of these things apart from your illumination. I am not anything to stand here before this great congregation. So I pray humbly that you would speak through me, that you would open our eyes to what you want to hear. Edit me today, Holy Spirit. You know I have a lot of words. I wish my voice could change so the men wouldn't grate at this high-pitched old woman. So, Father, just give them grace on their ears. And I just thank you for this family. I love this family, but not as much as you do. So I just bless them as we open your word. Open us up in Jesus' name. Amen. Hebrews chapter 12. My son Luke, he's the handsome pastor with the blonde hair. My daughter, Jess, she's the beautiful blonde. And my son, Dan, he's the handsome pastor, our senior pastor with the dark hair. I have a wonderful family. They have taught us marvelously and beautifully. My son opened us up on this course of discipline, and no one really chooses, I don't think, to teach this. This isn't like, oh, can't wait to teach about God's discipline. Ooh, whoopee. But that's the thing about going line upon line, is that you don't miss things. And that's how God would have us teach, so that we, as pastors, instruct you in the training of righteousness, so that we don't get stuck on just the fun messages, but we actually go through all of it. Because there's a big, big thing happening here. And there's a whole new kingdom we've got to understand. And so we've been looking at discipline and God's system of discipline. And Pastor Dan taught us last week beautifully about how God brings discipline through his word. It's the number one tool that God uses. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for correction, instruction, rebuke, doctrine, that the man and the woman of God may be instructed and be fully mature, able to do what they need to do. They need to grow up. And that's exactly what this is about, is that God is wanting us to grow up. He doesn't want us to stay immature children. He wants us to come to the table of the Lord and to actually receive the family business and receive the responsibility so we can go into the highways and byways and we can do business on this earth through the kingdom of God. Are you with me? So we have to grow up for that. Now, the title of this message is Take It Like a Son. I title it that way because we are all sons of God. God isn't hung up on gender. There's neither male nor female. There's not bond or free, that was slave or free, and there's not Jew or Gentile. Now, in God's eyes, there's only two races on the planet. There was the Jewish race, which had the salvation and the covenants, whereby salvation to this planet came through the Jewish race, and everybody else were Gentiles, so it didn't matter what color you were Gentiles. So unless you're born Jewish, you are Gentiles, right? So God isn't hung up on that. And so God is telling us that we're to take it like a son. Now, discipline is an interesting topic, and I named it that way because we're sons. The girls are sons, and the men are the bride. So just deal with it, because we're the bride of Christ. So men have to learn from us. I think we can teach you some things about submitting, loving, and the sons teach us so much. And so it's not about male or female. But the reason I title it this way is because I'm married to this crazy man, Pastor Jim. We've been married 38 years, and that man has absolutely taken me on the ride of my life. Divorced 3 times before he was 25. He married everybody, and everybody threw him out. Played baseball and flunked out of baseball. Wasn't a student. Was a businessman. He never thought in the world he'd be qualified to be a preacher, never be a pastor, because the man has a third grade reading level, a little dyslexic. You see, it's not about us. It's about what God wants us to do and what God anoints us to do. And so when Jim was growing up, he had this family. His dad was Rudy and his mom was Ellen. And they were first generation immigrants here in the United States. Their people came from other places. And they were in love, and they had 2 boys, Gary and Jim. And I mean, those boys, they were boys. And they were fighting all the time. Ellen would have to just take a glass of water and throw the water on their faces because they'd be fighting, and she couldn't separate them. So when Rudy'd get home, you know, he's going to get disciplined. And so Gary and Jim would run. They would run. They would run outside. They'd run around the house. Rudy couldn't catch them. And so finally, Rudy'd take off his belt. You know, those were the days when we could beat our kids. Take off his belt, and he'd say something. He'd say, "Get in here and take it like a man." And they'd have to come in, and they'd have to just hunker down and take the discipline because they screwed up. So I entitled this message, "Take It Like a Son," because I want to talk to you today about the prophet of discipline and how and what God does, a system that he uses so that you and I, at the end of the discipline, because it doesn't last forever, actually, we grow and we're profit. And there's some wonderful things that have to be in our life. Now, the first thing we have to undo, and that's what these other precious pastors have been teaching, is God doesn't break your legs and kill your kids, and he's up in heaven with a big stick waiting to take you out. That is not God's discipline. However, God is a God of providence. That word is not a word we use in our language. But let me tell you what providence is, divine providence. Divine providence is the protective care of God over his creation. God is the creator of heaven and earth, and all that occurs in the universe takes place under divine providence. That is, under God's sovereign, protective guidance and control. God is God in heaven, and God is God in earth, and he ultimately is sovereign. He's God. Would you agree with that? So that means that things are going to happen in our lives and things are going to come at us. God didn't send them, but God's going to use them. And so there are 2 things that I want to look at today about that. But before I do, let me just give you this quote. We're talking about correction and the profit of it and what it does in us and how do we get and stay in that trial and that test and that discipline long enough to actually reap the profit of what it's going to do in our lives. God is not destroying me. God is restoring me. The process will involve discipline and correction, born out of love, not wrath, born out of anger. Pastor Rick Warren said this, and I thought it was worthy of repeating. The purpose of punishment is to inflict penalty. The purpose of discipline is to promote growth. The focus of punishment is on the past, what you've done wrong. The focus of discipline is on the future, what you can be. The attitude behind punishment is anger. The attitude behind discipline is love. God does not bring disaster upon us to destroy us. But if God is sovereign in heaven and in earth, then nothing that happens to me or comes into my life is beyond his gaze. Is that not true? This is where theology splits. And this is where we have the theology, well, God's just trying to teach you something, or you did something wrong and you've sinned, right? And in a sense, we're all right about that because there's a lot we don't know. But I can tell you this. God is doing two things through the process. Number one, in Romans 8:28, it says, for God is causing all things to work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. And number two, Romans 12:21, do not be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. So now we've been talking about discipline. And this last verse, do not be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. I want to step out on that and look at this. Because you and I are here on planet Earth going through a process of first and foremost redemption. We're bought back by God. Then we go through a process of reconciliation. We are brought to God. The Holy Spirit comes in us. First, he was near us in the Old Testament, God near us. Then God was with us, Emmanuel, God with us. Now, according to Colossians, Christ Jesus, the hope of glory, Christ in me. Now the Spirit of God can be back in me. Now I'm joined back to the Father. Now I am not merely a human. I am a new creation, and there is a kingdom that I have been translated into, and there's a whole new system that operates that I need to learn. And I can stay in my old nature and my immature thinking, and that's carnal, fleshly. Or I can decide that maybe there's more to this than meets the eye, and I'm not just here being good so I can go to heaven, but I'm actually here on this planet being trained and being restored and being renewed and learning to operate and to function, not just merely as a human being, but now as a new creation in Christ Jesus and operate in the kingdom of God in this natural world. If you and I stay immature, if we stay locked into the natural, will never experience the supernatural kingdom of heaven here on earth and be the church that he needs us to be. You know, the press can't figure out why Trump won. I can tell you why Trump won. The church prayed. We said, Lord, we can't keep killing babies like this. There's innocent blood on our hands. There's innocent blood. When you take a baby out of the womb a day before it's born and it has no rights and you smother it, that's innocent blood. And we're doing that, and we can't keep doing that. Things are changing. It's not about tribes, illegal or undocumented immigrants or African Americans, because it's not about race. This is about the kingdom of God. And I think Donald Trump has a lot to learn, and there's a lot that's offensive about that man to me. But he's God's choice. He's in, and my choice now is to pray and believe God. But I know God is doing something in this United States, and when the church prays, there will be change. But we've got to grow up enough to pray the right way. You can be mad, but that's because you're still carnal, because God says, there's something I need you to know. There's something I need you to step into. There's something I need you to see. You're no longer just human beings. You're no longer just men and women. You are now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. You are now my children, born of the Spirit of God, and I need you to begin to operate like your King Jesus. Having said that, speaking of discipline, when things come at us, God causes all things to work together for good, and he's wanting us to learn to overcome evil with good. What hostile sinners mean for harm, God means for good. What they will be as hurtful, God wills as helpful. What they plan as destruction, God plans as salvation. What they design as a deterrent to faith, God designs as a discipline of faith. Therefore, suffering, afflictions, persecutions, evil circumstances, everything that can come to us and will, but it will only come under the divine providence of our Father. God will always use all things to work together for the good to those that love him and are called according to his purpose. And we are being trained in overcoming evil with good. This is training. Discipline is correction and training. Training. Let me show you. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 12. Now let's read. I'm going to begin with verse 2, and we're going to go through verse 10. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You've not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. And have you forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as sons? Do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For the Lord, whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, if, notice the if. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate. That word in the King James is you are a bastard. You have no father. You have no inheritance. You have no name. Then you are illegitimate. Furthermore, we have human fathers who corrected us and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best to them. But, he for our profit. There is a profit in what is happening, and there's a story behind a story, and there's a plan behind a plan, and there is a kingdom that is invisible that wants to begin to move in our lives, and God is training us to overcome evil with good, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Here comes the prophet. Partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward, it won't last forever. It yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. We are under training. We are undergoing a process of change from glory to glory, from day to day, from month to month, from season to season. We are not mere human beings any longer. We're in this world, not of it. And there is a system and a process of training that we must all undertake so that we can grow and receive the profit of what these things are. Therefore, having said all that, and that's a mouthful, God doesn't break my arms and kill my kids to teach me things. But God will use everything in my life, good and bad, to train me so that I can become a partaker and overcome evil with good. Therefore, having said that, this is what we're being trained to do. Are you ready? Amy Carmichael, and I'm going to use Amy as an example, was a missionary in the 19th century to India. She was a single woman from Ireland. Amy was the first woman who was an opened up rescue for sexual slaves. Because Amy was sent to India by herself, and she began to rescue children, boys and girls, out of sexual slavery in the Hindu temples that their parents had sent them to. She lived in India for the rest of her days. She wrote over 40 books, and she was an incredible woman like Mother Teresa that changed her world and is changing our world. If you've ever read a book of Amy Carmichael's, it will change your life. And this is what Amy said, the founder of the Dawn of Air Missions in India. She said, nothing anyone can do to us can injure us unless we submit to the wrong reaction. Nothing that happens in your life, nothing that comes at you can hurt you unless you submit to the wrong reaction. Now, what does that mean? It means it's not what everyone does to us or what negative circumstances come into our lives that injures us, but it is the way we take it. It's the spirit in which we respond, and our Father wants us to learn to be creative in this world and not reactive. You're not in control of what comes at you or what happens to you. But God wants me to grow up so that I can be in control of how I respond. If you spit at me, you do not make me mad. You make me wet. You take your saliva, you propel it out of your mouth as an insult to me, and it lands somewhere on my body or my face. How I respond to that action will determine what is on the inside of me. I told you we're dual nature. We have the old nature, the old program. We still are dealing with it. When we got saved, we didn't get perfected. Have you noticed that? We're instantly perfect in the spirit. We're righteous before God, holy and sanctified before him. But guess what? There's a whole reprogramming going on in our minds. We got to learn who the king is and what this kingdom is all about. There's an operation of faith here. We operate in the natural. Now we got to learn to believe God for the invisible. We know by faith that the invisible created the natural. It's more real than this, but I live in the real, and I can't see the invisible. So I have to begin to operate and learn how to operate in faith. Learn how to operate in the principles of the kingdom of heaven, because they are completely opposite of this natural world. Case in point, the king of all creation made all things. Jesus Christ, the word made flesh, all things were created by him and for him and through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. He created visible and invisible thrones. He created it all. And when he stepped out of eternity and stepped into the womb of that virgin, and when he became human, where did God birth him? In a lambing stable. His first bed was a manger. Do you think God's saying something in that? He wasn't born in a palace. He was born in a lambing stall, Bethlehem. The king of the universe. He didn't come as a glorious man. He came as a Jew, as a baby. Nobody knew he was even there except a few shepherds on the night watch and some wise men that looked up, studied the stars. You see, God's ways are not our ways. And God is not trying to get us into a measure of success like this world. God is bringing us into where the power and the glory really is, the kingdom of heaven, and everything operates second. It operates differently. So you spit at me, you don't make me wet. You don't make me mad, you make me wet. God wants me to be and respond like Jesus in the kingdom in a creative way. A creative way that creates or controls a situation. A reactive way means that I'm acting in response to the stimuli that's come at me. You understand the difference? You can be on the defense, or you can begin to change the atmosphere. Case in point, when they spit at Jesus, he didn't spit back. When they reviled at him, he kept his mouth shut. He's our example. He said, the law says an eye for an eye. There's a new kingdom. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violence take it by force. I'm bringing in a new kingdom. His first message, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. There's something here, church. We've got to see it. There's a whole new way to live. There's a power beyond anything we know. It's the power of agape love, because God is love. He's put that love into us. The divine nature is now in us. Just like Adam needed a wife that looked like him, God's making a bride that looks like Jesus. And the nature of Jesus is now the nature of the church. And we are learning to rule and reign on this planet in agape love, the power of God. But if we stay in the old default program, we're never going to grow out of this. We're going to stay angry, stay prejudiced, stay foolish. Stay as children. Well, God is saying, I want to bring you out of that and bring you into this unbelievable kingdom where anything is possible, and I can use you in the business, and you can propagate the kingdom of heaven all over this planet in your generation. So the response. This thing is about how we respond. Will I be creative and controlling a situation, or will I stay reactive, responding in an old nature way to what happens to me? The only difference between reactive and creative, if I can have that up there, there it is. The letters are the same. The only difference is the C. It's where it's placed. You see that? Reactive has the C in the center. It's all about me. I'm protecting me. What comes at me, it's all about me. But yet, creative has a C at the beginning. It's all about him. I'm being led by him. I'm doing what he wants. They want to kill me? Doesn't matter. I'm going to learn how to forgive them like Stephen, the first martyr, and cried out to God, don't lay this sin to their offense, and he closed his eyes in sleep. Huh. How about that one? It's all about the Apostle Paul writing to the church, and Timothy as the pastor, and saying, I want you to pray for those that are leaders over you. Now, who was the king? Nero was the king. Nero was burning Christians in his gardens. Nero was throwing Christians to the Colosseums. Pray for him? I want to run from him. I want to see him dead. But you see, there's a power. There's a force. There's a substance beyond anything we can see. It's the kingdom of heaven, and God wants to bring it to earth, and he does it through his church. Because we are his hands, his legs, his arms, his heartbeat, and God works his will through the church. He said he is the head, we are the body. All things are under his feet. That means all things are under our feet. But they're not under our feet in the flesh. They are under our feet in the spirit. So I have to learn how to respond. It's training when evil comes at me. God doesn't send it, but God will use it. What the enemy means to take you out, God means that thing to put you over. And the very mess that you're in becomes the very message of your life. And the very test that you have to go through becomes the testimony for others that God took me through this. God showed me how to respond to it. It doesn't last forever. It's going to end, but there's going to be profit when it's over because something's going to happen in my life and I'm going to have profit and increase. I'm going to be a partaker of his holiness. I'm going to have peace in my life, and I'm going to have fruit of righteousness. So quickly, I just want to see that. When does this church end? I got to hurry. So discipline is not for every day. Discipline is a season. And God says it's profitable for you. It's going to train you. It does three things. Let's quickly look. We'll wrap it up. Are you all right with me? It's about your response and my response. It's not about what happens to me. It's about how I respond. God is far more concerned with my character and my heart than he is what I do. He doesn't care about success as the world knows it. He cares about success as he knows it. And he's weaning me away from a dependence on the things of this world. Money, power, success, so that we feel good about ourselves. God wants me to feel good about myself, whether it looks like I'm in failure or success, because I belong to him. For the women, you know what'll happen to us? It's happened to me. You may be beautiful when you're young, but guess what? You're going to get old if you don't die young. It's going to wean you away from your flesh, from what you used to be. And men, you used to be strong and fertile. Man, you chase that woman all over. You're going to grow old. Life's going to change. Body's going to change. Why? Because he's weaning us away from the dependence of this temple of dust. And he's making us found in him, depending on him, knowing him, seeing what cannot be seen, hearing what you could not hear, and understanding what you could never understand. Because the kingdom now is so real to you, and the king is your Lord and your master. That you are being trained in righteousness. So partakers, prophet, holiness. Let's talk about it quickly. What does it mean to be a partaker of holiness? We just read it, Hebrews 12, 10 and 11. For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who've been trained by it. So number one, holiness. What does it mean? It means the word whole, W-H-O-L-E. Pastor Jack Hayford taught me this. Brilliant teacher. Holiness is purity. Hagios is what it means. That there's nothing in it but what it is. that God is holy. God is never less than who he is. He is never diminished. He is never less than God. When he creates, he doesn't run out of creation power, and he doesn't have to stop and rest because he's got to recharge and plug into something. He is the energy. He is the life. He is the plug. When God made the heavens and the earth and rested on the seventh day, he rested not because he was tired. He rested because he was finished. God is omniscient, all-knowing. He knows everything. He knows everything. He knows the hairs on my head. He knows what makes you you. He knows why you are the way you are. He knows your ancestors from 10 generations back. He knows. He has all the answers. God is omnipresent. He's everywhere. You can't escape him. You can't run from him. He's God. He's never diminished. He never wears out. He never changes. He is constant and whole. W-H-O-L-E. Altogether holy. Now, when I'm a partaker of his holiness, what does that mean? It means he wants me, with my new nature, to come into this wholeness. To come into this purity of life position. I'm holy before him because of the blood of Jesus. But now I've got the position is holy, but now I've got to practice it. And now on the inside of me, there's a desire not to do what I used to do. You see, he wants me to overcome evil with good. He's holy. What is evil? Evil is a perversion of that which is good. Evil existed only because there was good. Because Satan, evil was originated in Satan when he said, I will be like the Most High apart from the Most High. And he set up his own kingdom. Are you with me? So now here we are. And God is saying, I've given you holiness. I want you to partake of it. What does that mean? It means that inside of you, as you are trained by your responses to the evil that comes at you, you're learning how to overcome evil with good because you'll have no part of the evil. That's why Jesus said, pray for your enemies. Pray for those that persecute you and misuse you. You don't like the president? Then pray for him. Don't try to kill him or take your mouth and destroy him with your words because they have power. You don't know who you are. Are you hearing me, church? And if we remain carnal, if we remain fleshly, we'll never learn these things and we'll never change or grow up and we're going to stay the same in our families and this generation and this nation and the world is at stake because God so loved the world that he sent his son and his son has sent the church. Yeah. How about this one? Peace. Peace. Peace means that no matter what's raging around me, I'm okay. God's got this, and I know he's got this, and I'm all right. I may hate it. I may not like it. I may want out of it, but I'm all right. Paul said, I've learned to be content in whatever situation I'm in. You see, it's a learning process. You just not just beam me up, Scotty, and he just downloads all this into us. We walk this out every day in our lives, knowing two things, that God causes all things to work together for good, to those that love him and are called according to his purpose, and that God is training us to overcome evil with good and to be like Jesus. There's a verse that I've used in my life, Colossians 3:15 in the Amplified, if I could have it up. Peace. You see, you're going to be in situations where all hell's breaking loose. You don't know if God's doing it or if God's not doing it. You don't know what's going on in your life. But God says, hold on, hold steady, because my peace will keep you. Colossians 3:15 says, and let the peace and the soul harmony which comes from Christ rule, act as an umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your soul. What does that mean? It means when you don't know, he does. Remember, he's omniscient, all-knowing. He knows what's coming at you. He knows where it's coming and what it looks like. It's invisible, most of it, and you can't see it. He uses flesh and blood, but he says we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and rulers in high places. So you can't see the invisible. You only see the natural. We're fighting this battle in the natural, but supernaturally. So that tells me that he's an umpire of my soul. When I don't know what to do, I can pray and I can say, Holy Spirit, I don't know what to do. What's going on? And I see him with a black and a white shirt and a whistle. He stands on the sidelines and he's the umpire. He blows the whistle. He shows you the plays. He tells you where there's fouls that you're doing. He's also the coach and tells you and instructs you. So when you pray and you don't know something and you're going, why is this happening? What's going on here? What am I supposed to do? And you get a peace. You can stay in that thing. If you need to make a decision, you get a peace. You can move forward and keep knocking, seeking, and asking. But boy, when you get the whistle, you better take a step back. I call it the You know the How many know the Yeah, some of you are thinking, what? What's the That's the only way I know how to say it. When you pray and ask God, am I supposed to do this? Is this happening to me because? What the world is going on here? Am I supposed to do this? Am I supposed to go this direction? What are you teaching me? What's going on? And I pray about something specific, and I get a check. That means I'm to step back and do nothing until I get peace. Because the Holy Spirit's saying it's either not time, it's the wrong door, it's a deception, it's a test, it's a trial, it's a temptation. Don't move there. You've got to Umpire's blown his whistle. So you wait until you get I have peace. God's saying yes. And you take the next step because this is a narrow road. It's narrow. Wide is a road that leads to destruction, but narrow is a road that leads to life. And the more you know about God, the narrower that road gets. And people have blown it in their old age. Because they didn't listen to the peace of God. Now, the last one is righteousness. What is righteousness? Here's a simple definition. A child can understand this. There's always a position, and with a position, there is a corresponding practice. This is not just something that we are, it's something that we do. It translates into flesh everyday life where I walk out my salvation and live it out as a shining light and a living epistle to this world. Are you with me on that? God has made me righteous. It's to be right with God. God looks at me and he doesn't see my sin. He doesn't see my past. He doesn't see all the things that have happened to me. Why? Because Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, he imparted the sin of the world on him. And therefore, when I believe in Christ and that faith translates me into God's kingdom and he becomes my Lord and my Savior, then that righteousness is imparted to me. And God sees me not as a sinner, but now I'm a child of God. That's why I can cry out with the Holy Spirit, Abba, Father. He's my Father. I'm in his kingdom. And I am favored and loved and beloved by the Father, not just the Son. Wow. But the corresponding practice to be right with God is to do right for God. The position is to be right with God. The practice is to do right for him. What does that mean? This is such a simple explanation. But it means that in my life, I now have the ability to walk out the good works that he's already ordained from the beginnings of the world for me. My God assignment on this planet has already been settled. Now I have to find it and walk in it. And the grace of God and the power of God will equip me to do what he's called me to do, not because I have ability, but because now the righteousness of God and the grace of God and the power of God is in me, and I can walk it out, and I can do the impossible, and I can do what never was dreamed in my life. I can break off generational curses. I can change the destiny of my family. We can build a church like this that we would have never dreamed we even qualified to do. Why? Because we're righteous. That's the prophet. Now, in the last 5 minutes, I'm going to give you three quick things. How do I stay in this place of hardship long enough to get the prophet? Because I can tell you what you get, but now quickly, how do I get it? Number one, clearly in the Word, out of this passage of Scripture, God is training me in response so that I can live a creative life, not a reactive life. So I can change the circumstances by ruling in my spirit through the Holy Spirit, not the flesh. He says, number one, you are going to have to consider Jesus. Hebrews 12:3, for consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Consider him. Look at him. Add up the facts. He's the prototype. He's the model. He's the show and tell teacher. When I don't know what to do, when I'm asking God, have I done something? Are you angry with me? Is this punishment from you? I can begin to pray and I can begin to look at Jesus. And Jesus went to Gethsemane and he said, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. And you see, the battle for Calvary was won at Gethsemane, not at the cross. It had already been won. He sweated drops of blood, not wanting to be separated from the Father. That which is holy was going to become sin itself. And yet he said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And when you think that you have struggled and that you can't take it one more day, you have not sweated drops of blood.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me, church?
Yeah.
Calvary was a horrendous and horrific event, but the real event was at Gethsemane when the Godhead would be separated for the first time. And absolute life would take on sin. Absolute life would release spirit and die as a human, go into the depths of hell. But death and hell couldn't hold him because he was innocent, because Satan had destroyed an innocent man, and therefore he didn't know who he was, just like we don't know who he is. And you see, the Lamb of God, God himself, the creator of heaven and earth, took the keys of death and hell. He went back up, took his blood on the mercy seat, and Satan didn't even know what happened. It was the biggest coup d'etat in the universe. Consider Jesus. Add up the facts. Number two, endure the process. Oh, you're going to want to get out of the oven. It's too hot. Oh, I don't want to stay here. I don't know what the heck's going on. You want to grow weary. You want to get angry with God. You want to get bitter. God, what are you doing? Talk to me. You ever felt that way? Endure the process. Verse 7, if you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. Endure. It's not the passive resignation to fate, but it's the active, energetic resistance to defeat that allows brave and calm endurance. You don't get out of the oven. You stay there until it's fully cooked. Joseph would have never gotten to Pharaoh's throne. His brothers hadn't betrayed him, if he hadn't been falsely accused by Potiphar's wife, if he didn't spend 13 years as a slave and in prison, when that butler came into his cell and he was about to die and he had that dream and Joseph interpreted that dream and he said, please don't forget me. Please tell Pharaoh. The butler forgot him for 3 years. Delay, delay, delay. Delay. You want to get out. You want to circumvent. You want to stop. You want to run. You want to quit. Get me out of here. But you see, when you stay put and you endure, then in the season and the time and when it's all right, when everything's ready in the fullness of time, God brought forth his son, born of a woman. It couldn't be any other time but Rome. It had to be the time. God is sovereign. He's provident over our lives. He knows the times and the seasons. He has you in an oven, but he's going to get you out. And in that oven, he gives you grace to stay. And he'll begin to show you what's in your heart. He'll begin to deal with you about these things that you have to be weaned from. Ego, selfish ambition, all of these things that must be crucified out of us so there can be a resurrection of new nature. Are you hearing me? Endure. Stay put. And the last one is quickly obey. Quickly obey. Listen, in this season of time, it's not a time to get him any more mad. Not that he is. Sometimes he is. Moses got God pretty mad. I saw a sign once that said, Jesus is coming back, and boy, is he the P word. Where'd he go if God's mad at you? Quickly submit. Verse 9, furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us. We paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? There is a Zoe life, a God kind of life. God wants for me, but I'm going to have to be in subjection. I have to come under authority. I have to submit, and I have to let him deal with my life because he's not after my physical success. He is after my character, and he's developing the agape power and love of God in me, and all of these things are working together. Man, when God tells you something in that trial, do it. When he shows you things in your heart through that hard time, say, yes, sir, and repent quickly. He'll give you the grace to change because you can't change yourself. You didn't even know it was there, right? You look at yourself and you want to loathe yourself sometimes. You think, all that crap was in there. Oh, I said crap. Oh, well. See, through this season, these things are happening in your life. Why? So that you can have profit. So that you can be a partaker of his holiness. So that you can live with the umpire of your soul. He can blow the whistle and he can open the doors and you can walk through. And in the tough times when nothing's happening, he settles you down. And you and him just enjoy his presence and you are okay until the doors open. And he wants you to be a partaker of the fruit of righteousness because he's already ordained these things. When Moses was trained by God and when he was 40 years old, he thought he was the Messiah for Israel. Stephen said in Acts chapter 7, verse 22, that Moses was mighty in word and deed. And when he went to go rescue his brothers and killed that Egyptian, he ran for his life. For 40 years, the prince of Egypt was in the desert, a nothing and a nobody. And then that burning bush shows up. And then God says, now you're ready. I hear the cry of my people, I'm sending you. I hear the cry of my people, I'm sending you. I hear the cry of my people, I'm sending you. I hear the cry of my people, I'm sending you. God doesn't do it without you. And Moses says, oh, no, 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 I'm not eloquent in speech. You can't send me. I'm a timid man. 2 chapters he argues with God until finally God gets angry. He says, Moses, I'm sending you with your brother then. He has a mouth. He'll speak for you. What is God saying? All right, you've been trained. Now get up and get going. Strengthen those hands that are down and those knees that don't want to walk. It's time to get up. Get up. Get up. Why? Because Moses, if you don't get up, you're going to miss parting the Red Sea. You're going to miss the victory of Pharaoh. You're going to miss me on the mountain. You're going to miss when I pass by creation and you write the first 5 books of the Old Testament, the Torah. You're going to miss all of these things if you don't get up. Your trial is over. You're going to take these people back to the wilderness. They will be humbled, but you've already walked the way, and you'll be their shepherd, and you'll be their leader. And it's the same thing with our king. He's already walked the way. He knows where the minefields are. He knows what's going on. And if we'll consider him, number one, if we will endure the season and not get out, and if we will quickly obey when God speaks, then, beloved, we will be partakers of his holiness. All the resources are open to us. Nothing broken, nothing missing. We will have the peace of God in our lives every day. And we'll have the fruit of righteousness. There are journeys and tasks for this congregation to walk in. There are things you're assigned to that no one else can do if you don't do it. It's time to get up, straighten up, stay in the trial. Don't get out because God's got an adventure you can't even imagine. I have gone way too long, and I'm sure you're exhausted. You can't meet with the king. I've had the privilege of being able for 38 years that I've been married to Jim, to pastor with him. We didn't know women couldn't be in ministry, so he just invited me right along. You can't study the word and see the master and begin to understand some of these things and not be passionate. We have 30-minute messages and we have these quick glimpses because we're told you can't take it and you're too immature and our attention span is too short. But I believe that sitting in this auditorium, there's a generation of supernatural sons and daughters. And God wants to pour his spirit out on you and through you. And that there is a job to be done and there are things to do before the great and the mighty day of God's wrath and the return of the king. And this is life and death. So thank you for being so good and tolerating me. And right now, before we end, I'm going to quickly do this. Some of you came because you were invited, and that person that invited you is probably thinking, oh, my gosh, Pastor Deborah's preaching. Where's Pastor Dana? Pastor Luke? But God brought you here, not because you were invited, but because it's the plan of God for you to hear. I've preached the gospel to you, this message. You've heard of the King, the God who redeemed us through Jesus. He restored us and reconciled us. And all of this kingdom and all of these things are available to us. But one thing God will not do is he will not force it on us. This is a free will decision. God didn't make robots. He births sons and daughters, and he invites you into this kingdom. The simple truth is, if you've never surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to Jesus Christ, letting him become Savior and Lord in your life, no matter how good you try to be, how much you go to church, you're never going to be what you're supposed to be or be a part of God's kingdom. Because there's only one way to the God's kingdom. It's through Jesus Christ. All roads do not lead to heaven. Only one. And the price is beyond anything you and I can imagine. So God says, you've got to make a decision. I'm knocking on the door of your heart. Will you let me in? Will you come in with me and let me come in with you? Will you surrender your life to me and let me be your Savior and your Lord? Some of you are saying, you don't know what I'm involved in. No, I don't, but God does. He's not in therapy over it, and he knows you can't change yourself or your circumstance, but he can. So don't let that stop your decision today. Some of you are better than I'll ever dream of being, but your goodness will not get you to heaven. Do you know Jesus in your heart? Have you made him your Savior and your Lord? Is he your sovereign? And are you submitted to my Lord the King? And if you've never done that, with heads bowed now and eyes closed, just the last moments of this service, I'm going to give you a moment of privacy with just you and God. Nobody's looking around. If you were to die tonight, where would you go? Because you're eternal. God's put eternity in our hearts. You are made in the image of God, and there is a living spirit on the inside of you. It's going to either live in heaven or it's going to live in hell. God didn't make you for hell. He made you for heaven. But there's only one way, his way. Have you surrendered your heart and your life to Jesus? All over this auditorium, I remember the moment I was living with a man. I was doing drugs. I was a wicked girl, rebellious. And I'd hear the gospel message and I'd say, oh, I got to get myself right. I know it's true, but I'm not worthy of it. But you see, what I didn't know is that God knew I could never change, but all I had to do was say yes, and he would change me from the inside out. So he knows what your living situation is. He knows what your addictions are. He knows what your life is. He knows it. He knows you can't change it, but he can. But he can't change it if you won't give him permission, because he's given you a free will. I'm going to ask in just a moment, if you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm going to ask you to lift your hands with heads bowed and eyes closed. I'm going to ask us to do it together. I'm just going to count to three, and I'm going to just slap this pulpit and just do it together. You don't get saved by raising your hand, but it's the beginning. Are you ready? One, two, three. If you need to get right with God, raise your hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Raise them high. Raise them high. I see that hand. I see that hand. Raise them high. Is Jesus your Lord? Is it time to make Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life? Raise your hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Now, you don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting him into your heart. So now as we stand, I'm going to ask you to do a courageous thing. If your God can die for you on a cross naked and stripped, then you can come with everything that you brought to church and walk an aisle and meet me down here, and let's pray and let's get right with God as we sing this song. If you didn't raise your hand, it's not too late to come. Come quickly, though, and let's get right with God. God's not mad at you. He loves you. He brought you here to save you. He brought you here to change you. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. No one can change you but God.
Every morning, new every morning, great is thy faithfulness, O Lord.
There's at least 20 of you that should should be down here, but you're not. But I cannot make you come. I can only invite you to come and meet the King of Glory and come and become a son or a daughter.
Every morning, great is thy
faith. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation.
Great is thy faith.
This world has thrown you out, and Satan sees you as sheep for the slaughter. But God loved you so much that he wouldn't live without you.
New every morning.
I know what it is about this section. I know you are not all saved and sanctified. But enough. Enough. Jim says, I'm sweating like a little gorilla. I said, it's not sweat, it's glistening. Look up at me. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday party. When you were born, God assigned angels to you. It's how much he thinks of you. It says that when you come to the King, that those angels have a party. They're high-fiving. Yeah, it happened. Doesn't mean they get any rest. God knows. But he loves you more than you can imagine. He knows you. He created you. And he has a plan. But you don't get saved by walking an aisle. You get saved in a private place. We want to pray with you. Not in front, but privately. So this is Pastor Joel. And we have a little place that's private. Your friends can meet you there. It won't take long. We want to pray and give you a Bible and just talk to you for a minute. Well done. If you turn left and just follow Pastor Joel.